God said, "Let there be light."
And there was light.
Jesus said, "I am the light of the world."
And the light shone in the darkness.
Jesus said, "You are the light of the world."
And the light shall not be quenched.
And our opening prayer, Eternal Spirit, Creator of all places and people, we come together in this name of the Christ. In him you became one with us, that we might become one with one another in the worship of you. This is the time for a Black History moment. And I know that there are at least two people in the congregation who are ready and willing to share a Black History moment. So if those two people would stand, come to the front, wherever.
African Americans have served our military for many, many years. In 17 July 1862, there were two acts passed to allow the African Americans to enlist in the United States military. July 1948, President Truman abolished racial discrimination in the United States military. The Harlem Hellfighters, the 369th Infantry Regiment, which served the front lines for 191 days during World War I, longer than any other American unit, was one of the most highly decorated Black units. Contributions in key roles in the military dated back to the American Revolution. One unit was called the Buffalo Soldiers, known for their rugged and tireless marching. And this nickname for the Negro Cavalry was given to them in September 21st, 1866, at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, during the Indian Wars. During World War II, a young man, Dory Miller, received the Navy Cross as a recipient while under fire during the Pearl Harbor attack. He saved his captain, and then he manned a gun until he was ordered to leave the bridge. For that, he received the Navy Cross. On October 25, 1940, Benjamin Davis became the first African American to be promoted to Brigadier General, and he was part of the Buffalo Soldiers. President Roosevelt created a flying organization for the colored troops. And you've probably heard the name, the Tuskegee Airmen. Well, it was Benjamin Davis's great-grandson, Benjamin Davis Jr., who headed that. And if you watch the president on the State of the Union, one of the Tuskegee Airmen was on that night and was awarded and promoted to Brigadier General, and he turned 100 years old. The first Black Medal of Honor recipient was William H. Kearny, and in February 17, 1863, William was born a slave in Norfolk in 1840. His father escaped slavery through the Underground Railroad, and then his father settled in New Bedford with the family, and William learned to read, and he was interested in becoming a minister. Instead, he joined the Army. And while he was in the Army, he was under attack, and the gentleman carrying the colored flag for his unit was shot. He picked up the flag and proceeded to carry it throughout that at the end of the attack. He told them this flag didn't touch the ground one time. He was shot four times. 40 years later, he was awarded the highest military honor, the Medal of Honor. There are hundreds and thousands of stories about Black Americans in the military. I urge you to read them and find out more about men and women of our military.
This is a multiple choice question, A, B, or C, and it's for a new car. The first Black billionaire was Oprah Winfrey, Michael Jordan, or Robert Johnson?
You say billionaire?
Billionaire.
Robert Johnson.
Yeah. Robert Johnson. Do you know why?
No.
He owned the Black International Television Station and sold it in 2001. CPAP got the car.
This man that he mentioned was a cook on the ship, and he manned that deck gun. I have wondered how he learned how to operate a deck gun. You're not born knowing how to do that. Somehow he learned on his own. But it was reported in the newspaper a few weeks ago, there will be an aircraft carrier named for this sailor when the next carrier is built.
As you know, we have a lot of colonial history in the area since the United States started here. There was a slave, James Armistead, who was born in New Kent County. And during the Revolutionary War, the British said that any slave who would help fight on the British side would be given their freedom. So he defected to the British side. What they didn't know is that actually it was all a ruse. He was not defecting at all. He was a spy for the colonials. And somehow he managed to go back and forth between the two. He ended up over in Portsmouth towards the end of the last year of the Revolutionary War. Benedict Arnold actually had his headquarters for a brief time on High Street in Portsmouth. And James Armistead was there and heard the plans about the British attacking Yorktown. He was able to get the news to Washington and to Lafayette, and they were able to actually win the Revolutionary War because of James Armistead. After the war, he was not given his freedom by his master, because they said, well, you didn't actually fight in the war, you were just a spy. Even though since then historians have said that he was, that was the most influential act of any spy during the Revolutionary War. It actually turned, it ended the war. We won because of it. In the 1820s, Lafayette came back to the United States and did a tour of the former colonies all up and down the East Coast. And when he came to Portsmouth, James Armistead came there and he was finally given his freedom. And then he took as his last name Lafayette. So there's actually an arch over in Portsmouth in Old Town where Lafayette spoke in the 1820s when he did his tour of the US, and where he also reconnected with James Armistead, and where James Armistead was given his freedom. But we actually won the Revolutionary War because of a slave. So, and also the first person to die in the Revolutionary War was an African American in the Boston Massacre.
Now, I stand here as at least a living part of Black history. I met Robert Johnson. Of course, that didn't make me a millionaire. And his wife, I don't know whether he kept that $1 billion long, because after his divorce, his wife got a big chunk of it. And she purchased, she's the owner of the Washington Mystics basketball, professional women's basketball team. She also owns a golf course in Florida, so he was a billionaire for a minute. But you might be interested, the first African-American millionaire was Madam C.J. Walker, who lived in Richmond, Virginia. So now you know. And somehow my family, I don't know how they got it, it's not Black history, but you mentioned the Amistad that some of my cousins have researched their family tree and found out that President John Quincy Adams is numbered among those who are in our family tree. And of course, I stand here, I don't know what, you know, I'm probably the first African-American who didn't know what to say at this time. I'm indebted to you, and I ask you to do that as an assignment, and I'm glad that somebody has taken it up. And we don't want the moment to turn into an hour, so let us continue with our worship. Oh, also, one other bit of Black history. This song that you chose, my first solo part in the school when I was a little kid in church, was the one, Brother, Will You Trust in the Lord? I had to leave that off.
How about that? God works in mysterious ways.
And I haven't been singing since. Okay. You want to continue?
Thank you to everyone who shared. You know, God created us all. It doesn't matter about the color of our skin. He created us and he loves us. And we need to spend more time building each other up and realizing the important things that we have done as his children. Turn your attention, please, to the prayer for illumination on the bottom of page 2. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our scripture reader today will be Selena Collins.
From the Old Testament lesson, Song of Solomon 4, verses 1 through 7. How beautiful you are, my darling. Oh, how beautiful. Your eyes behind your veil are doves. Your hair is like a flock of goats descending from the hills of Gilead. Your teeth are like a flock of sheep just shorn, coming up from the washing. Each has its twin. Not one of them is alone. Your lips are like a scarlet ribbon. Your mouth is lovely. Your temples behind your veil are like the halves of a pomegranate. Your neck is like the Tower of David, built with the courses of stone. On it hang 1,000 shields, all of them shields of warriors. Your breasts are like two fawns, like twin fawns of a gazelle that browse among the lilies. Until the day breaks and the shadows flee, I will go to the mountain of myrrh and to the hill of incense. You are altogether beautiful, my darling. There is no flaw in you. The New Testament of lesson comes from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 33a. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Lord, benevolent Lord, we, your children, come to you right now asking that you would be with us. Help us, God, to be the children that you have created us to be. Give us strength when we're weak. Give us weakness where we're too strong. Humble us that we might be able to know your will for our lives. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who calls us beyond ourselves into a love that will not let us go. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Well, since we're already into a little bit of Black history, there is a song, a secular song, that I trust that none of you have ever heard. It was sung by one Percy Sledge and Michael Bolton and a few other persons. It's called When a Man Loves a Woman. If you will just allow me to read the words of that song, maybe we can get off on a good note. When a man loves a woman, can't keep his mind on nothing else, he'll trade the world for the good things he's found. If she's bad, he can't see it. She can do no wrong. Turn his back on his best friend if he puts her down. When a man loves a woman, spend his very last dime trying to hold on to what he needs. He'd give up all his comfort, sleep out in the rain, if she said that's the way it ought to be. Well, this man loves a woman. I gave you everything I had, trying to hold on to your precious love. Baby, please don't treat me bad. When a man loves a woman down deep in his soul, she can bring him such misery if she plays him for a fool. He's the last one to know loving eyes can't ever see. When a man loves a woman, he can do no wrong. He can never own some other girl. Yes, when a man loves a woman, I know exactly how he feels. 'Cause baby, 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 you're my world. Now that's gospel in the street. The first time I preached this title, many of the members of Asbury United Methodist Church in Washington, D.C. said that they each kept trying to remember all the words. Then I had no intention of knowing all of them, because beyond the title, the song had little reference to my sermon. Of course, that was before I used any parts of the Song of Solomon as a scripture reference. Speaking of the Song of Solomon, it is perfectly all right to read its content once in a while. You don't see it too often in the common lectionary, and sometimes in some churches, pastors won't even bring it up. It's a love song, and it's, if you look in your Bibles at home, it may be, now the part that Sister Selena read this morning would normally be read by a man. And then there are parts in that Song of Solomon that are read by a woman to the man. I do warn you When you read it, you ought to read it in twos. And married couples should share it only. Now, if you're unmarried and just shacking up, you should have your marriage license in hand and my number in your book. The Song of Solomon, according to Orthodox Judaism, is a favorite read on Friday nights. I'm told that on many Friday nights, the children are sent to bed early. The wife, having recently completed her menses and now purified, puts on a special dress and sits down with her husband. They together, according to the male and female parts of the song, take turns reading to each other. Now remember, I said this is just for husband and wife. The warning is because many wonderful things might result from its reading. Now, if you're married, you ladies might dab a little bright red lip gloss on, and you men might dab a little sweet fragrance behind your ears and on other critical junctures of your anatomy, and perhaps wait to see what the end is going to be. For all you other folks, you just need to read it and weep. This pre-Valentine sermon is just for married folks. I guess some of the rest of you might hum a few lines of the song that I just said by Percy Sledge and wonder why you're yet single. If it's because you want to be, then you can just enjoy the song for its lyrics. But if it's because you believe the report in the song, I feel only pity for you. You need to turn your attention to the book of Ephesians, fifth chapter, beginning with the 25th verse, and continuing down until you understand what it is that God has to say about how you should treat a partner when you get one. All of you then can forget some of the words to the song and get on with being a man in a godly relationship with a woman. Sometimes I think part of the American male problem is that too many men think themselves God in a manly relationship rather than a man in a godly relationship. If anything will cause a married man problems like Percy sings about, it is trying to be a god to your wife. She's not your possession. She is not supposed to wash your socks and cook all of your meals. Now, wait a minute. Are you ladies going to allow me to take up a collection after this? She's not your possession. She is not supposed to wash your socks and cook all of your meals and hold down a full-time job and raise your children while you take an occasional turn at babysitting on Friday or Saturday night. I could never understand men who think spending a few hours with their children while their wives take a breather think they're babysitting. Man, those are your children. If you would spend more than an average of 3 minutes a day with any one of them, you might be on track for what God says men should be about. I know I'm right. But my being right is not the point. The point is that when a man loves a woman, he cannot do anything shameful or wicked or sinful. The book says that when a man loves a woman, he loves her as he loves his own flesh. Some fellas love your wives better than that during the first 2 years, or was it the first 6 months? I don't know what happened, but something did. I can't explain for you because I can't explain for myself. I just know that we don't bring sweet little honey lumps flowers anymore. The only answer I can offer is that we forget or never knew what God has to say about it. Some men just read scripture that instructs the wife. At least this is so for those who read it at all. Ephesians has some interesting instructions for males. Listen again as I read it slow as it is written. I'm thinking about the story of a GI who wrote to his girlfriend and said, "I am writing this letter slow because I know you don't read fast." Sometimes we need to read these words a little slower and savor their meaning. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Let me read it slow again. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Fellas, which word did you not understand? On which of these few words do you need more time to reflect? It may be that you understand completely. It could be that the position description for a godly husband was not available to you before you took the best years that Jane had to give. Maybe this is why you fit the description of a husband for which a newly married woman went to her pastor. She said, "Brother preacher, I want a divorce." He said, "Lucille, I'm sorry, you just can't get a divorce. You remember, you took him for better or for worse." She said, "But he's worse than I took him for." And some of us are worse than she took us for. Some of us think that loving our wives means ownership over their minds, their bodies, and their spirits. No. Love means just the opposite. It means that we are responsible for their spiritual health, and that can only happen when she feels free enough to make her own choices. Percy's song was right. When a man loves a woman, he can do her no wrong. He can never hug some other girl. In fact, boyfriend hasn't got any business even looking at another girl. Not only is a husband supposed to love his wife, but also he is charged with the awesome responsibility of giving himself for her. That's what Christ did for the church. In order for the church to live, Christ gave his life. My prayer is that this is not an absolute, but if it should become necessary, whether she looks exactly like she did at 17 or not. A Christian husband ought to be willing to put himself on the line for her. Much like Brother Keith said on the golf course, I said to Brother Keith, I said, "Brother Keith, you got two birdies." He said, "No, I got two birdies and an opal." I am truly sorry, men, but it is not my idea of a fun day on the farm. It is God's word. I cannot help that you were in such a big hurry to have her that you did not stop to read the instructions that came with the ceremony. The Word of God says that this is necessary that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the Word. Now it reads like this because I am substituting her for it, your wife, for the church, that he might present her to himself a glorious love, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. Remember, we are substituting our wives wherever it speaks about the church. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. Ladies, I would be very careful here if I were you. You might want to look around the room to see just what results you might accept were this the case. If some of us loved you like we love our own bodies, you wouldn't have much love. I'm afraid some of you might decide to be a little less loved. But wives, isn't this great stuff? Most of you have been fed by the earlier verses that say how you are supposed to relate to your husband. But when you read this part, your part becomes easy. In fact, it becomes downright fun stuff. How could you not reverence a man like this? How could you help but honor him and love him if he takes such good care of you? He should be the one bringing you to church every Sunday. Some of you have been bringing him. I tell you, this is good stuff. It gets even better with a few readings of the Song of Solomon on a Friday night when the moon is full and bright. I had better stop here. I don't want any runaway teenagers, we don't have any good for that, who take this Song of Solomon and go out and do some mischief. I had better stop here. I don't want this to be taken the wrong way. But when you read the Song of Solomon, it gets steamy. I remember in seminary, my professor did an experiment. She had this handsome young man read the male part, and this beautiful young girl read the female part. And I tell you, we got the squirming in our seats like nobody's business. It was absolutely breathtaking. It's a great book to sit around a nice warm fire on any night. Not necessarily Fridays. Just remember that it only works if you were married. He that loveth his wife loveth himself, the book says. For no man ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, even as the Lord the church. For this cause shall man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife. And they shall be one flesh. For what cause? What is it that shall cause a man to leave his birth family to start his own? Is it not to have a wife? It is not just because he is tired of staying home looking out the window. It is to love a wife in the way that Christ ordains. This is not just any kind of warm, fuzzy love. This is not the Eros kind of love only. Oh, it starts out that way. But it must turn to agape love. This is real love. This is love independent of whether she is the most beautiful or the most honorable woman in the world. This love has nothing to do with what a fine thing she is. It has everything to do with what a fine Christian man you are. In my humble opinion, this is where many marriages fail. He loves her because she loves him, or else he loves her because she can cook and clean and sew on buttons. The Bible says that he is to love her as Christ loves the church, and is to do so expecting nothing in return. Amen, light. Oh, he can hope for a return, but it's not a criteria for remaining faithful to the relationship. Oh, I'll bet my sermon song titles will not seem so appealing from now on. This is solid stuff on which great marriages are built. I know, Brenda, what's my excuse? I just have to preach this one more time, and I'll know it by heart. I'll get it right sooner or later. When a man loves a woman, can't keep his mind on nothing else. He'd trade the world for the good things he's found. The more I look at some of these words, the more I see what I didn't hear when I was grooving. The only words I heard was, he'll spend his very last dime trying to hold on to what he's found, and he'd give up all his comforts and sleep out in the rain if she said that's the way it ought to be. I was very young. I hope some of you are getting something out of this sermon. I'm trying to compare man's way to God's way for a meaningful relationship, a full relationship, and a healthy relationship. God says that when a man loves a woman, the stereo and the TV belongs to both of them. It is a relationship based on Christ's relationship to the church. Each of us can relate in some measure of how good it feels as a member of the body of Christ to know that we know that we know that Jesus loves us, that Jesus is always there for us. He's always willing to do battle for us and forgive us even when we are not as sound as we ought to be. God is a good God. When a man loves a woman, he will never mistreat her. He will never put more on her than she can bear. A Christian husband will hold her as the very object of his affection, just as Christ does the church. And even if she aggravates him to no end, he is to love, nourish, and cherish her until they are parted by death. I guess that means that Brenda can keep on turning off my westerns in favor of Everybody Loves Raymond and Andy Griffin. I know some of you think I have said enough. But if you are in for some serious conversation, you can imagine what I might be in for. Psych, I'm a perfect husband. You see, I run my home. I run the vacuum. I run the washer. And I run the errands. I know I am valuable to my wife. She told me once that she wouldn't trade me for anything. It would have to be valued at more than a dollar. She used to ask me whether I would love her when I'm old. According to these scriptures, I will if I can love anybody when I'm old. Now, some of you other men ought not to laugh. If you're hearing this sermon, God is expecting you to, who are bad, to do better. And the real bad to do something different. You who are not getting from your relationship may need to renew your relationship with Christ and allow him to show you just how fervently he loves the church so you can give and not get. Love is not love unless you are giving it away. I know, fellas, next week is Valentine's Day. Perhaps it is time to stop buying Valentines and start being Valentines. When a man loves a woman, he really becomes a man when his Christian love of neighbor extends to his closest neighbor. In the scriptures, a young lawyer asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor? Is not your significant other your neighbor also?" This is all really quite easy. We husbands must earn our rightful places as spiritual heads of our homes. We need to figure out how God loves the church and determine how then to love our wives. Did you take each other for better and for worse? And are you worse than she took you for? When a man loves a woman, can't keep his mind on nothing else, he'll trade the world for the good thing he's found. If she's bad, he can't see it. She can do no wrong, and he ought to turn his back on his best friend. This is the way I see it, and this is the way it ought to be. Amen.
I am tired and weary, but I must toil on till the Lord comes to call me away. Where the morning is bright and the Lamb is the light and the night is as fair as the day. Valley for me someday. There'll be peace in the valley for me. Oh Lord, I pray no more trouble or sorrow, not trouble I see. There'll be peace in the valley.
A book called Chicken Soup for the Soul by Jake Canfield and Mike Hansen, I believe. And in the very front, there's a Chinese proverb, and I'd like to dismiss you with that. If there is light in the soul, there will be beauty in the person. If there is beauty in the person, there will be harmony in the house. If there is harmony in the house, there will be order in the nation. If there is order in the nation, there will be peace in the world. Go in peace and be the peace that we need in this world. Amen.
Thank you.